Salut papa.
Joyeux Noël.
I picked that video for a couple of reasons. The first one being, it's a one-hit wonder, Redbone, back in 1972, my freshman year of Bible college when I met my wife. That was a song that was playing a lot. But more importantly is the fact that I am that old man. I mean, I see a cycle of life taking place when I look at that. I see that as he moves on up into age, he's able to pass on something, a love for a song that his son was able to have. You know, I'm that man, but I'm not French. I don't have a beard. I don't have that telephone, but I still have good moves. Shane, incidentally, does not have good moves. He's very awkward. When I was a senior at Central Christian College in Moberly, Missouri, they made you. I mean, it wasn't even a gee suggested. If you were going to graduate, you had to preach a senior sermon. Now, that means that you're preaching in front of the whole student body as well as all of the professors. I was terrified. I knew that I wasn't going to be a minister anyway. I didn't see the point in me having to preach there. I was going to be a youth minister so I could stay out of the pulpit. That was the plan. Nonetheless, my brother pushed me out on stage, and I remember being just my knees shaking, and the theme that I was selecting was one that I thought was important then, and I think it's important now. I had a sermon that said something like this: if I only had one sermon left to preach, what would it be? And you know, there was the sky was open to me as far as what I could preach about, but I looked at Jesus, who had the same circumstance. Jesus knew that he was getting ready to be crucified. He was wanting to talk to his disciples, and he said, get this right. You know, you don't just talk glibly when you know that hours away you will be crucified. You talk about things that really do matter. And out of all the things that Jesus could have talked about, he talked about this: learn to love one another. Learn to really, not just talk about loving one another, but learn to love one another. That was my senior sermon, John, the 13th chapter. Then I went begrudgingly, because if you're a youth minister, they'll love you to death and let you go poor. So I went to a preaching ministry in Liberty. My trial sermon, John, the 13th chapter, love one another. I was there for 6 years, and I came here. And my sermon was this: John 13, love one another. We've gone full circle here, and today you're going to hear a sermon, love one another, from John the 13th chapter. We'll begin and end the same way that we did years and years ago. And so before we do anything more, why don't we pray and ask God's blessing. Father, I do pray for your anointing today. Help us to understand deeply what you have in mind, the commandment that you gave us to love one another. I just thank you for the years that you've given me here, and I'm thankful for this congregation and this community, and I just pray your continued blessing on them, that the best is yet to come because you're in the middle of it. In Jesus' name, amen. John, the 13th chapter, verse 33 and following, it says, dear children, I'll be with you only a little longer. And as I told the Jewish leaders, you will search for me, but you can't come where I'm going. So I am now giving you a new commandment: love each other. Just as I have loved you, you should love each other. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples. We so grossly misunderstand what love is. It's not that sentimental, whimsical feeling that we have when we see someone for the first time of the opposite sex and say, hey, I'm going to fall in love. You even use words like that. But this is a love that's a love of choice. It's a love of character. It does not rely at all on feelings. It relies on character that says, I want to be like Christ. Christ loved this way. I want to love this way as well. He says a new commandment. Now, it wasn't new from the standpoint that it had never been said before. I mean, if you'll remember, I think that the most important thing that Jesus could have said was when they asked him, what's the greatest commandment? And he said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. On this, he says, hangs all of the law and the prophets. It all is hanging on that. So it's my privilege today to talk to you about loving. I want you to note something. In that text, Jesus says, it's a commandment. He doesn't say, if you feel like it. He doesn't say, if it's convenient for you, if it's at all possible. It's a command that he gives. Therefore, the type of love that he is speaking about is something that you have full control over. Too many times we let ourselves off the hook saying, I can't love them. I just can't do it. Christ could. That's the type of love that will make us unique. We find it hard to love our neighbors. He said, he's already taught that. And he said, I want you to love your neighbors in that periphery, that circle of influence that we have. It's often hard for us to love our neighbors, just people that are maybe people that we work with every day, people that we go to school with, just lots of these people on the perimeter, and it's hard sometimes to love those people. But it's even harder when Jesus said on the Sermon on the Mount, hey, love your enemies. Can you imagine? What is he talking about? I'm never going to have a warm, fuzzy feeling about that person. There's something that is deeper. There's something that is better than that. And he's saying, hey, that, you can do this. I want you to love your enemies. But today he says, I want you to love one another. And it's been my experience through the years that that's the hardest love. We don't give one another a break. We find ourselves so many times judgmental of people. We see them across, you can see them across the auditorium and you look at them and you think, I don't even like that person. You might not know them, but I just don't like them. Look, they're dressing to show off or whatever. And we have a tendency to be judgmental. As a matter of fact, more judgmental and more, sensitive. When someone in the church says something, it offends us quickly, more quickly than if we were in the workplace and someone had said the very same exact thing. It doesn't offend us like that. Satan does all that he can to try and figure out a way to make you and I not love one another. If God's church here is going to continue and it's going to be what God wants it to be, we have to love, and that love has to be unique. The world has got to look at that and say, that's different than what I see when people fall in love and get married. That's different. There's something that I don't quite understand here, but I like it. That's why he said, hey, by this will all men know that you're my disciples. In other words, you identify yourself with Christ, not through the church you go to, not through the fact that you come and give an offering, not through the fact that you attend regularly somewhere. He says, they're going to know that you are my disciples if you love one another. How is that playing out in your life? In Luke, the 22nd chapter, verse 31, Jesus is talking to Peter. And he says, Simon, Satan has asked to sift each of you like wheat. But I have pleaded in prayer for you, Simon, that your faith should not fail. So when you have repented and turned to me again, strengthen your brothers. Notice when he talks about Satan wanting to separate us, it wanting to sift us like wheat, he notices that, hey, there's something that happens there. Your faith is going to be tempted to fail. You'll be at your weakest point when you are estranged from other people in the church. He said, Satan has asked to sift you like wheat. And the important thing for you to know, he's still asking. He would still love nothing more in a time like this for you to find yourself at arm's length from everybody else. separated from them, judgmental of each other, harsh. It's easier just not to be hurt if we stay away from other people. You know, in this critical time that we are going through called a transition, it is one of those times where we potentially can be our weakest. And love is stronger than that. And you need to hang together like death warmed over, because you know that Satan will do whatever he can to destroy the work that God began here. You'll be tempted to be short-tempered with one another. Love is stronger than that. You'll be tempted to be judgmental of others. Love is stronger than that. You'll be tempted to be unforgiving. Love is stronger than that. As a matter of fact, Ephesians, the 4th chapter, verse 2 says, always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other. Notice this, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. You know, this thing that we call love in church, it's not just some sentimental, romantic thing. As a matter of fact, it is so strong that in 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, in verse 8, it says, love never fails. It just doesn't give up. It has a tenacity to it. If you know what the love that God wants for you to have for other people, you're able to love people that others wouldn't be able to do that. The world is going to look and see how you embrace those who are unembraceable. Our community is going to see how you accept people who are unacceptable. The world is going to look at us and ask how you can forgive the unforgivable. That is the love that God calls for. And it takes depth, it takes maturity, it takes our best effort, it takes asking God's Holy Spirit to help us in times where we are most weak. You have a choice. You can do this. And the impetus is on you. We often think that we can love people when they start being lovable. When they start doing things that we think, well, that's acceptable. No, the love that he's talking about, an agape perfect love, is that says, I can see you at your worst. I can see you when other people have thrown you to the curb. And I can still love you regardless of that. For 36 years, you have been loved. My family has loved you and you have loved us. Now I'm asking that you love Shane and his family as you love one another. Pray for them, encourage them, build them up. They were favored to win the men's 400 meter relay team in Beijing in 2008 Olympics. But the problem was that they'd gone through two different places where the different laps had done fine. And on the third one, their really strongest part of the team, something happened. Those first two legs, flawless. But then that critical third leg, and you've seen it on television, they've got a passing zone. It's 66 feet wide, and you have to pass the baton within those 66 feet or you're disqualified. The third runner was Darvis Patton, and he closed in on the final runner, Tyson Gay. Gay reached backwards, but they never did connect. Patton made a final lunge to get the stick in Gay's hand before he ran out of the zone. But as Gay's hand closed behind it, the stick wasn't in it. The baton was dropped. They were summarily disqualified. This is our time in the passing zone. This is our time to be able to, with great faith, just turn it into another generation and realize that God is going to do great things. I'd like to ask Shane and his family to come here along with the church's leadership if I could. You know, the Bible says the fastest runner doesn't always win. It's those who, with persistence and prayer, can go ahead and make a transition smoothly. And that's what we want to do today. You know, Shane, I give you this baton, turning over a senior minister to you, but I want you to know that this congregation will love you, but you love them first. They'll support you, but you support them first. They'll lift you up, but you make sure that you lift them up first. God's called you to that. I know I've got all confidence in the world that God's going to do great things through you.
Lord, we thank you for this day and what it represents. Lord, we want to thank you for Jay and Janie, all the years of dedicated service, Lord, to this community, to this church, Lord, and most importantly, you. We thank you for that, and we thank you for what you've done in the past, Lord, what you're doing now, and we look forward to what you'll do in the future. We thank you for Shane, Elizabeth, and their family, Lord, and the love that they've got for you and this church, Lord, and we just thank you for everything you've done for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you join with me for the first time in formally just greeting your new senior minister?
Thank you so much. I want to spend just a minute and address both Jay and Janie. I want to start with Janie. Janie, you have been by Jay's side every step of the way, and for that, you deserve a medal. You are proof that behind every good man is a great woman. Jay's ministry is not one that he had to go about alone. You have been his partner in ministry every step of the way, and you have gone above and beyond the call of duty. We came up with a list of some of the different roles and different areas in which Janie has served in over the past 36 years. And when you look at this list, all we could say is, wow. She has been the church piano player, the VBS director, the children's choir leader. You have overseen the women's ministry. You've been a life group leader, a Sunday school teacher, a ministry leader for the ambassadors. You've been a part of the kitchen ministry. You've helped with communion prep. You've led the seniors ministry. You've been a part of the prayer warrior team. And you have gone on hundreds, if not thousands, of hospital calls with Jay and also by yourself. You have been patient and supportive of Jay when his responsibilities here at the church have been demanding. During those times when he had to work long nights, or if you had to cut trips short because of an unexpected death in the church, or those times when Jay had to get up and he had to leave the dinner table to go minister to people during their time of need. Janie, you could have found hundreds of reasons to resent this church. I know that there has been times when your family has been unfairly scrutinized. There has been times when your husband has been unjustly criticized. But through it all, you have shown an unwavering love for the ministry of this church and for the people of this church. Janie, this ministry and this church would not be what she is today without you. So thank you. Jaybird, it's tough to even know where to begin, but the legacy and the impact that you are leaving here is incredible. You have brought a relational dynamic to the ministry of this church that is second to none. Joy and laughter are a huge part of the DNA of this church. And I know that a lot of you grew up in churches where you probably weren't allowed to have fun or laugh or smile. But here at First Christian, we laugh a lot, we smile, and we sure have a lot of fun. You have brought laughter to our lobby when you visit with people before and after services. You've brought laughter at times when it was appropriate, And at times when it was not appropriate, if we're being honest. You have brought joy and laughter to the workplace every single day. Jay, you have made coming to work fun. And I can promise you that joy and laughter are going to continue to be a part of who this church is. Jay, the love that you show every person in this place is unbelievable. It is a genuine love. You love the poor, the rich, the weak, and the strong all the same. I see Jesus in you every single time that you're in this place. And I am so glad that you are a man of faith. I'm sure that a lot of you here today aren't even aware of this, but you see, God put it on Jay's heart years ago that he wanted to do something new, something that was going to require big faith. And Jay listened. Jay shared with the leadership and the members of this church that he felt like God was calling First Christian to buy the land in which we are worshiping on today. And this happened years before the church on Vandalia had burned down. But I can say with confidence, Jay, that I would not be here today without your faith. The majority of our staff would not be here today if it wasn't for your faith. And I know that there are hundreds of people in our church that wouldn't be here today without your faith in God. Right now, I want to ask, if Jay has baptized you, if Jay has performed your wedding, or if Jay has done the funeral for one of your family members or loved ones, would you go ahead and would you please stand up? Jay, look around. Jay, God has used you in a way that I can only hope 30 years from now when I retire will look similar. You have made a tremendous impact. I don't think you're going to ever be able to fully comprehend or understand the impact that you have made until we get to heaven. And Jay, I want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart. Thank you for making that phone call a little over 3 years ago and asking me to consider to make the move here. I want to thank you for trusting me to continue the ministry and the work that you and Janie began here 36 years ago. I know that you could have chosen anyone, and the fact that you thought of me, that means the world. And you have never once wavered in your love or your support for me from the very beginning. There's times when I've made bad decisions and you still supported me and stood by me every step of the way. And we've been through a lot over these past 3 years, but I can say with confidence, I believe that you are leaving the church at its highest point. You know, when I made the move here, I got so much more than a boss, so much more than a coworker. I got a friend, and I value and treasure your friendship. And Jay, just because you're no longer the senior pastor of this church still needs a life of the party, and that's you. And I hope that you and Janie will be here every single weekend that you're in town to worship with us. And I know that you've said you feel like you need to give me space, but and you're doing that for me, but I want to let you know that I think that you are a tremendous asset for the future of the ministry of this church. You're not a roadblock, and we want you and your family to be here. Absolutely. And Jay, you may not be the senior pastor of this church, but this church is your family, and that is something that is never going to change. We love you. Well, we're going to close things today with one final song. And let me give you a little background on this song. The next song that we're going to do is a song called Death Was Arrested. And Jay heard this song, and I'm not quite sure when he heard this song, but he came in to one of our pastor's meetings all excited, and he said, "Perry, have you heard the song Death Was Arrested? We've got to do that song sometime." And Perry's like, "Yeah, I've heard that song." Nothing happened. A little while later, Jay said, "Hey, Perry, have you ever heard the song Death Was Arrested? That's a song that we should really do." And we did Death Was Arrested. I think it was Easter. And man, the smile on Jay's face when we did that song was great. So I cannot think of a more fitting song than to end this with than Death Was Arrested.
Sing it with me, church.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. The ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. And my orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over. I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom, and faithfully bore. He canceled my debt, and he called me his friend. When death was arrested, and my life began. Oh, your grace, so.
Yeah.
It's been awesome. Man, it's packed in here, isn't it? It's been awesome to worship with you guys and spend this time honoring our senior pastor. Go out in the foyer. He's out there with Janie. Go say hello. The party's not over yet. We'll continue honoring Jay and Janie next week with a special service. Make sure you come back for that. Have a good week. God bless.